Hello friends, my name is Rex and this is a video on the introduction to robot odometry. After watching, you should be familiar with the concept, understand how you would go about with implementation, and since this is a truly fascinating topic, you should also be dying to learn more about it. Now, this is the first of an entire series on the implementation of position tracking. Each part will be expanding on the topics introduced in the previous video, and by the end of the series, you should be able to create your own odometry code for your system, whether that be for a VEX or FRC robot, along with motion algorithms to go with it. It's true that odometry can get somewhat mathematically involved, but I assure you that it's all coming from a simple place. And so I really, really implore you to try and grapple with these concepts, as I promise you'll find them really rewarding, just like I have. I hope these resources prove to be helpful for both VEX and FRC teams, or really just anyone who wants to learn more about the amazing world of control theory. Now, without further ado, we have a lot to cover, so let's dive straight into it. Odometry is the general process of using motion sensors of any kind to detect changes in position, the most common of which are encoders, visual, and distance sensors. Using odometry, we can create an absolute positioning system to keep track of the robot's position and orientation during the entire length of a game autonomous or programming skills run. First, let's go over how such a system is created, then we'll talk about the strengths and weaknesses of using odometry. We will be focusing mainly on the use of encoders to develop our odometry system. These encoders will be attached to three nun-driven omni-wheels and positioned in this configuration, where the left and right encoders are parallel to each other, and the third encoder is perpendicular to the two. You might be wondering, why not just use the encoders on the drive wheel motors? And the reason why is because those wheels are prone to wheel slippage. When the robot accelerates and gives power to the motors, the drive wheels can slip a little bit before they actually gain traction and start to move. So it's more effective to add these three separate unpowered wheels, which we will call tracking wheels. These unpowered wheels, of course, won't have any motors attached to them, but they will be equipped with quadrature encoders or rotation sensors. Wheel slippage can be reduced depending on how heavy the robot is, so you may see that some heavier VEX bots and most FRC bots can get away with the drive encoders, but it is still recommended to install tracking wheels as they significantly increase the effectiveness of the positioning system. As the robot moves, these wheels roll against the ground, and using encoders to track their movement, we can effectively track the robot's position. In order to do anything with the data from these wheels though, we have to understand the math behind the odometry tracking theory, which I will be covering in the next video, so please consider subscribing and stick around for that. Now let's talk a little bit about the strengths and weaknesses of odometry. The obvious strengths of using an absolute positioning system is that you can now move relative to the field instead of the robot. This means instead of asking the robot to move forward 5 feet and turn 90 degrees, then move another 5 feet, I can just tell the robot to aim at specific coordinates on the field. Knowing the robot's position at all times opens up many options for motion. You could generate splines between two chosen coordinates and use path-following algorithms, such as PID controllers or peer pursuit, to get to your destination. Another advantage is that since the tracking wheels are always rubber banded down to the surface of the field, even when the robot jumps up due to sharp stops or drifting, the encoders will still be recording the values because the tracking wheels will always be in contact with the field. And using these readings from our tracking wheels, we can actually correct arbitrary errors in our movements, whether it's caused by battery percentage, bumping into an unforeseen obstacle, or an enemy defense bot. Since odometry lets the robot know wherever it is on the field, and we are aiming at absolute coordinates instead of moving in relative terms, the robot will compensate for any error so that even if it was off at a specific point in the routine, the next position it goes to will be accurate. In other words, if the robot was off at a certain point, it won't affect the movements following that, because odometry will correct for these errors. To see this in action, have a look at this video of Team 5225A's autonomous. As you can see, even though they were pushed off course by the enemy bot, since the robot still knew exactly where it was on the field, its next position was still accurate and they were able to complete the routine flawlessly. Now let's have a look at some weaknesses of odometry, although there really aren't many. The first is the amount of computation power needed to implement such a system. The odometry algorithm requires it to calculate its position at very short intervals to instantaneously update where it is on the field. Such complicated calculations can really stretch the limits of some hardware, such as the old VEX Cortex M3. But honestly, this shouldn't be a problem for the V5 brain or FRC motor controllers. Another weakness is that odometry errors occasionally accumulates over time due to slipping or skidding of the wheels and numerical integration error. However, using unpowered wheels mostly mitigates this, and for autonomous routines that are less than a few minutes, odometry still proves to be a very, very accurate tool for position tracking. Alright, that's it for now. I hope you liked this video and found it helpful. If you have any questions, feel free to leave a comment down below and I'll do my best to answer them. As you can probably tell, I'm a big fan of odometry and control theory, and I really hope I can get you into it too. If you liked this video, please give it a thumbs up, it really, really helps. And please consider subscribing if you don't want to miss the next video on odometry implementation. Thank you so much for your support, and I look forward to seeing you in the next video.